As a 19-year-old security guard, Nathan became a victim of circumstance. He was pulled over for a routine traffic stop and wound up being arrested for armed robbery, one he did not commit. After being arrested, he was denied counsel and subjected to several days of interrogation without food or water. Eventually, he broke down and confessed. Nathan figured he'd get out on bail, get himself a lawyer, and straighten everything out. But because he had confessed to this bogus rap, Nathan's lawyer said he was looking at 10 to 12 years in prison. Now, you can't blame the guy for being a little angry, but it was at this point when Nathan's volatile temper completely took over. He figured since he was going to do the time, he might as well commit the crime. So while out on bail, Nathan got himself a gun and proceeded to commit a string of armed robberies. He wasn't innocent anymore. Nathan served 10 years in prison, 10 very turbulent years that shaped the mind and the soul of the man we see today. I would like to issue this warning right up front. A lot of what Mr. Jones has to share about his time in prison is very disturbing and extremely graphic in nature. With that in mind, viewer discretion is strongly advised.
I found the idea of going to prison, strangely enough, exciting. Frightening, but exciting all at the same time. It was an adventure. Straight away, when I turned up to the prison, they backed the paddy wagon up to N Division. N Division's the old part of the jail. It's the solitary confinement where they put all the bad, worst of the worst. The thing is, I hadn't done anything wrong at this time. And they put me straight there because of my size. I took two steps, I hit a wall. Two of my steps, of course. And it was the pitch black darkness. I was kept there for 7 months. Yeah, so I had a few adventures in there. I remember one time they wanted me to put the handcuffs on, but I refused. I didn't trust them. My hands bound. So I refused. They filled myself for a mace. First time I've experienced it. So my eyes are burning, I was choking, I couldn't breathe properly. It freaked me out, so I put my arms in the bottom and stuffed this. They ended up putting the handcuffs on me, and I went into the paddy wagon. And they sent me off to the courthouse. It was like a 2-hour trip. My eyes are burning and I was getting more and more angry with the situation. So I end up ripping the seats up, the steel bars that were holding the seats, tore them out, and in the back of the paddy wagon, I started ripping out the little bars in between me and the police officers that were driving it. It was like a truck, and it was like separate. There was like a window and then another separate window with a separate cabin. So I ended up ripping through. I smashed my way through both windows where the police officer grabbed the radio and started yelling, "He's coming through, he's coming through." And the whole van starts going sideways and starts veering off the road into the ditch. And I remember the police officer sitting in the driver's side. He's trying to grab his gun. I could actually reach the gun and grab it if I wanted to. And I'm trying to pull the gun out of a holster and he couldn't get it out because he hadn't unclipped it yet. And then he eventually unclipped and pulled the gun out and pointed the gun at me, shaking. And I immediately said, "If you're gonna shoot me right between the eyes, because you wouldn't stop me anywhere else." And I think I scared him a little. So he started shaking even more and saying, "He's crazy." And he ends up dropping the gun, it falls behind the seat and he's stumbling, trying to get the gun, get hold of the gun. He managed to get it again. They stopped the van and he's sort of standing back outside the door, not wanting to get too close, pointing the gun at me. I just kept on looking at him, staring at him. And they called the tactical response group. They came in with their machine guns and their shotguns, and they sent some detectives in to talk to me. And they asked me what I wanted. I said, oh, well, you know, they're asking me what I was. I said, oh, well, you know, I want a bar of chocolate. Make it a big bar of chocolate and a couple of chickens, you know. And what else? So I thought, oh, you know, well, yeah, I want these handcuffs taken. I want those zip ties, you know, like the ones and the more comfortable, you know, not hurt my wrists. And I like a limousine. The limousine I thought was a bit much, but they gave it to me anyway. I was surprised, so it was nice. And also I wanted a shower to get all the mace, because it was still affecting me. Yeah, so yeah, it was fun. It broke the boredom. I remember the first time I kicked off in the doors, it was when the prison officers were on strike. And we hadn't been fed all morning, it was going into the evening, and I just started kicking. Everyone was kicking their doors. There was 750 prisoners kicking their doors, yelling and screaming. And I just got into the, you know, the rhythm of things as well. So I started kicking the door, and eventually my door unbuckled and it came off the hinges. I didn't know I could do it, it just happened. And I proceeded to make my way straight to the kitchen. And then I broke my way into the kitchen and I helped myself to food. And I thought, you know, help out a few of my mates. I loaded up, I took it back to the other cells and I started feeding the other prisoners through the bars and turned on the television and started watching TV. And I remember the chief, he was running across the compound, terrified. You know, I've never seen anyone do that before.
As we showed you earlier tonight, Nathan Jones has had a very complicated path throughout his early adulthood. But even before that, things were not exactly normal for Nathan. As a child, other kids refused to play sports with him because he was so much bigger than everybody else, he would hurt them. His parents routinely brought him to bars when he was just 12 years old. Even then, he was so big, full-grown men would challenge him to fights on a regular basis. For Nathan Jones, facing aggression with aggression has been a way of life all his life. And some things most likely will never change.
Well, one of my first fights when I was in prison, I was with a big Tongan. He's about 6'4", I think, about probably 120 kilos, 130 maybe. He hit me. They usually sucker punch me. He's told my size, even when they're big, you know, and they hit me in the jaw. I think about the ear, somewhere around the ear. And straight away, I attacked him. I hit him with some palms and busted up his nose and his mouth. But he was a tough guy. He's looking at the blood on his face. I don't know if you can say this on television, but you bastard. And then he tackles me, right? And he bites me on the neck. I'm not really in the trapeze right here. I feel the pain. The next thing I grab his head, I see his ear. The first thing I thought, either rip his eye or bite his ear. So it's because he's going to bite a chunk out of me. So I bit his ear off and straight away freaked out. And he's holding his ear. I remember he put his hand in front of me. And this is a pretty vicious fight. And he put his hand, his finger went into my mouth. And he went to push my eye bit onto his finger. And I held on to it. And we went down to the ground and I started hitting him with elbows. Eventually some prisoners came over and said, stop. You know, and I was sort of, oh, yeah. He got pretty vicious in there and he went to hospital. I broke his, I think, shattered his cheekbone, his jaw with the elbows, his ear. Yeah. Although he, to put it how seriously, he strangled a prisoner to death while he was in there. He was a builder, a bully. There was another instance with another prisoner. He was in for a double murder. He bashed two men to death. And he used to see a point himself to, like, you know, inflict pain on people anytime. He lied to me, it suited him, and I had confrontations with him where he beat up a friend of mine. I took a dislike to that. So I walked right amongst the whole group of them, and I attacked him. I think it threw them off, like, just freaked them out. So I knocked him down, and I think I'm gonna kick him. But, no, I'm not gonna kick him. I'm gonna let him get back up. I'm gonna humiliate him in front of all his peers, you know? So I let him get back up straight away. I didn't just go straight and as he got back up, I could see him putting his head down, getting into position. And I say, I'm gonna take your head off. I remember squeezing my fist really tight, and I did this big wild swing. I could have sent him a telegram to tell him what was coming. But he managed to duck, but he's swinging. I never took my eyes off his head. I remember seeing the whites of his eyes peering, and I swung back, and I managed to smash him in the head with my elbow in the temple. And he's still boom, and straight away I followed through with a punch in the same spot. And I kept on following through with more elbows into the top of his head, around here. He went down to the ground. So I think I grabbed him by the throat and I started strangling him. I wanted to make him believe he was gonna die. Honestly. I wanted to take him to the point that he thought he was gonna die, because I wanted to make them feel the same way as they made other people feel, and make them feel terror. I terrorized them. But these were bullies, and they deserved it.